please stand.
Lord, by shedding his blood for us, your Son, Jesus the Christ, established the Paschal mystery. In your goodness, make us holy and watch over us always. We pray all this through Christ our Lord.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance and his appearance beyond that of the sons of men. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured, while we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father, I put my life in your hand. Father, I put my life in your hands. In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Into your hands I commend my spirit. You will redeem me, faithful God. For all my foes reproach me, neighbors laugh and friends stand off. I am forgotten like dead unremembered, I am like a dish cast down. Father, I put my life but my trust is in you, O Lord. I say you are my God. Into your hands I place my future. From the clutch of foes you rescue me. Father, let your face shine on your servant. Oh, save me in your love. Be stout-hearted and come, take courage, all you who now hope in the Lord. Father,
reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Praise and honor to you, O Lord Jesus Christ.
Praise and honor to you, O Lord Jesus Christ.
Christ obeyed until death, even death on a cross. Now God has exalted him and set him above all names.
Praise and honor to you, O Lord Jesus.
The Passion of Our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John.
Down the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem that day, the soldiers tried to clear the narrow streets, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head. And he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary.
Jesus went forth with his disciples across the Kidron Valley, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, procuring a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to befall him, came forward and said to them,
"Whom do you seek?"
They answered him,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus said to them,
"I am he."
Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them.
Rabbi!
Again, Jesus asked them,
Whom do you seek?
And they said,
Jesus of Nazareth!
I have told you that I am he, so if you seek me, let these men go.
This was to fulfill the word which he had spoken, Of those whom thou gavest me, I lost not one. Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus.
Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup which my father has given me?
So the band of soldiers and their captain, and the officers of the Jews, seized Jesus and bound him. First they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had given counsel to the Jews that it was expedient that one man should die for the people. Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. As this disciple was known to the high priest, he entered the court of the high priest along with Jesus, while Peter stood outside at the door. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the maid who kept the door and brought Peter in.
Are you not also one of this man's disciples?
No, I am not.
Now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire, because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching.
I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogues and in the temple, where all Jews come together. I have said nothing secretly. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he said this, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand.
Is that any way to speak to the high priest?
If I have spoken wrongly, bear witness to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Annas then sent him, bound, to Caiaphas the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself.
Didn't I see you in the garden with the Nazarene?
No, you did not.
One of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked,
Did I not see you in the garden with him?
No, I tell you, I do not know this man.
Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was early. They themselves did not enter the praetorium, so that they might not be defiled, but might eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said,
What accusation do you bring against this man?
Well, if this man were not an evildoer, we would not have handed him over.
Taking yourselves and judging by your own law.
Governor, it is not lawful for us to put any man to death.
This was to fulfill the word which Jesus had spoken, to show by what death he was to die. Pilate entered the praetorium again and called Jesus.
Are you the king of the Jews?
Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?
Am I a Jew? Your own nation and chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?
My kingship is not of this world. If my kingship were of this world, my servants would fight, that I might not be handed over to the Jews. But my kingship is not from the world.
So you are a king?
You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice.
Truth? What is truth?
After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them,
I find no crime in you, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. Will you have me release for you the king of the Jews?
Barabbas!
Now Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and scourged him. Soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him, saying,
All hail, King of the Jews!
Pilate went out again and said to them,
See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no crime in him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe.
Behold the man!
Crucify him!
Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no crime in him.
We have a law, and by that law he ought to die, because he has made himself the Son of God.
When Pilate heard these words, he was the more afraid. He entered the praetorium again and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
But Jesus gave no answer.
You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and power to crucify you?
You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me to you has the greater sin.
Upon this, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king sets himself against Caesar.
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the pavement, and in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews,
Behold your king.
Crucify him.
Take him yourselves and crucify him.
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and he went out, bearing his own cross, to the place called the place of a skull, which is called in Hebrew, Golgotha.
Thank you. help him.
they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote a title and put it on the cross. It read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek.
Do not write the King of the Jews, but rather write man who said, I am King of the Jews.
What I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and made four parts, one for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was without seam, woven from top to bottom. So they said to one another,
Let us not tear it, cast lots for it to see whose it shall be.
This was to fulfill the scripture, they parted my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. So the soldiers did this. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing near, he said to his mother,
Woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
Behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing all that now was all finished, said, to fulfill the scripture,
I thirst.
A bowl full of vinegar stood there, so they put a sponge full of the vinegar on hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the vinegar, he said,
It is finished.
And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
On his head, spear in his side. Still, it was a heartache that made him cry. He gave his life so you would understand. Is there any way you could say no to this man? Tear-stained eyes, knowing that it's you he's thinking of. Could you tell him you're not ready now to give him your life? Could you say that you don't think you need his love? If Christ himself was standing glory, his eyes full of tears, if he reached out his arms with his nail-printed hand, is there any way you could say no to this man? How could you look into his tear-stained eyes, knowing that it's you thinking of? Could you tell him you're not ready now to give him your life? Could you say that you don't think you need his love? Well, Jesus is here with his arms open wide. You can see him with your heart. Stop looking with your eyes. He's left it up to you. He's done all that he can. Is there any way you could say no to this man? How could you look naked to his tear-stained eyes, knowing that it's you he's thinking of. Could you tell him you're not ready now to give him your life? Could you say that you don't think you need his love? Thorns on his head, your life is hands. Is there any way you could say no to this man?
Since it was the day of preparation, in order to prevent the bodies from remaining on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place, that the scripture might be fulfilled, not a bone of him shall be broken. And again, another scripture says, they shall look on him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him leave. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who had at first come to him by night, came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds weight. They took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb where no one had ever been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, as the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there.
Could I ask you to be seated? When I was received into the church, I received my first Holy Communion at a Saturday morning daily mass. The priest who had instructed me in the faith and who would give me my first Holy Communion, Father Jerry Osterman, a good friend of Father Jim's and a friend of Father Bill's and mine, at St. Paul's in Cambridge, was less liturgically strict than I am now. And he allowed me to choose the readings for that Mass. And for the Gospel, I chose the parable of the prodigal son, Luke 15. The story that Jesus told of the ungrateful young man who took his father's inheritance and squandered it on loose living. I think that story resonates with us all, but it connected with me in a very personal way. I knew that I had been at the end of my rope for a long time, and that the Father had not only forgiven me and welcomed me to my true home for the first time in my life, but that he had been also waiting for me patiently from the beginning of time. And then as now, it blew me away. The story of the prodigal son is very much the story of a loving father who not only waits for the return of the son he loves, but also runs out to meet him on the way home. My first communion had, really for me, the feeling of a feast, of a celebration. Truly, I was lost, but now is found, once dead in sin, but now alive in God's love. It was only many years later that I really paid attention to the character of the elder son in the story. You remember him, the one who was angered by his father's outpouring of generous love? Of course, the elder son's reasoning was perfect. The son of yours turned his back on you, ran away, wasted your money on dissolute living, and you throw a party for him? Meanwhile, I've always been faithful, and you've never even noticed me. One of the great things, most beautiful things about the parables that Jesus tells us is that they're most often left open-ended. We never find out in Luke whether the father was able to convince his older son to come into the feast that he had thrown for the younger one. We never know if the elder son reconciled himself to the fact of his father's generous love, whether he too, like his younger brother, was converted and won over by the father's witness of extreme sacrificial love. But if you're like me, you hope that the elder son was converted too. How could we not believe that at times during his earthly ministry, Jesus became as exasperated with us as the elder brother in that parable was exasperated with his ungrateful younger sibling? Listen to how he spoke to us, his brothers, from time to time. To Philip, he said, "Have I been with you so long and you still do not understand?" To Peter, his greatest friend, he said, "Get thee behind me, you Satan." To the authorities in the temple, he said, "Take these things away. You will not make my Father's house a place of trade." Yet the story that plays out before us here tonight, this greatest of all stories told every Good Friday, is the story of an elder brother who was converted, who, St. Paul says, and we heard tonight, learned obedience from what he suffered and became the source of eternal salvation. Just as much as our salvation is the work of an ever-loving Father, we are reminded here tonight that it is also the willful act of our elder brother. Yes, we are prodigal children indeed. In our selfishness, in our greed, in our desire for the good things of this world as opposed to a desire for more intimate union with the one who created us, we all turn our backs on him and we squander the inheritance that he has given to us. And yes, the Father does indeed wait for us, watchfully, lovingly, constantly. And he will run out to meet us when we, like the younger son in that far-off, famine-struck land, finally come to our senses and decide to return to him. But we are so much more greatly blessed. Unlike the prodigal son in Jesus' parable, our elder brother is also full of the Father's love. Our elder brother was not jealous of the love that the Father had for us, his adopted children. Rather, he cooperated willingly in the plan that returned us to being a family again as we were meant. A plan that beat him and bloodied him and required of him his very life. On Saturday night at the Easter Vigil, Father Bill will sing the Easter proclamation, the Exultet, an absolutely beautiful song of God's undying love for his children, the song of our salvation history. I have always been terribly moved by one line in particular in that great song. It's a line that encapsulates the ridiculous, spendthrift love our God has for us, we his prodigal children. And that line is this: "Father, how wonderful your care for us. How boundless your merciful love. To ransom a slave, you gave away your only son." We are so blessed. 2,000 years ago, folks only marginally older than these teens here tonight witnessed the height of love, as Father Bill said last night, sacrificial love, played out by their friend, their brother, Jesus. This night, we witness this fatherly, brotherly, sacrificial love again, as we do each Good Friday. And we pray that we too might become a witness, an older brother, and that we too might love as he has.
Behold, behold, the Lord of the cross.
Following the teens, you're invited to come forward and to adore the wood of the cross. We remind you that this is not a time for prayer, but a time for adoration, and that there are many who want to come close to him.
Behold the cross on which was hung. Lies buried, Lord, God's darling one, Mary's own name, so cold and so still, helpless before her on Calvary. Nails in his hands, nails in his feet, a traitor kiss upon his cheek, and his pierced heart now broken in two, love crucified for me.
Beautiful the hands that served, the wine.
hear you on the wind, whispering to me. In this quiet place again, I have found a friend who understands me. Where you are is where I. Great is your faithfulness, O God of Jacob. You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. You lead me by still waters into mercy, where nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. For your grace is enough, yeah, your your love and justice, God of Jacob. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of heaven's victory, and all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. For your grace is enough, yeah, your grace is enough, yeah, your grace is enough, yeah. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. For your grace is enough, yeah, your grace is enough, yeah, your grace is enough, yeah, your the Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul, and I will trust in you. Jesus Christ, I think upon your sacrifice. You became nothing, poured out to death. Many times I've wandered at your gift of life, and I'm in that place once again. I'm in that place once again.
Once again I look upon.
Once again I look upon the cross where you died.
I'm humbled by your mercy.
I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again I thank you. Once again I pour out.
to the highest place, King of the heavens, where one day I'll bow. But for now, I marvel at this saving grace, and I'm full of praise once again. I'm full of praise once again.
Once again, I look upon the cross where you died.
Once again, I look upon the cross where you died.
I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken.
I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside.
Once again, I thank you.
Once again, I thank you. Once again, I pour out my life.
Thank you for the cross.
Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend.
I ask you to stand for our prayers of the faithful.
Let us pray, dear friends, for the Holy Church of God throughout the world, that God, our Almighty Father, guide it and gather it together so that we may worship in peace and tranquility. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for our Holy Father, Pope Benedict the
16th,
that God, who chose him to be bishop, may give him health and strength to guide and govern God's holy people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for Cardinal Sean, our archbishop, for all bishops, priests, and deacons, for all who have a special ministry in the church, and for all God's people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the victims of sexual abuse by clergy, that the current efforts of our church may help towards their healing and reconciliation. May they know God's great love for them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those among us preparing for baptism, that our merciful God may make them responsive to his love, forgive their sins through the waters of new birth, and give them life in Jesus Christ, our Lord. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all our brothers and sisters who share our faith in Jesus Christ, that God may gather and keep together in church all those who seek the truth with sincerity. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the Jewish people, the first to hear the word of God, that they may continue to grow in the love of God's name and in faithfulness to God's covenant. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those who do not believe in Christ, that the light of the Holy Spirit may show them the way to salvation. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those who do not believe in God, that they may find him by sincerely following all that is right. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those who serve us in public office, that God may guide their minds and hearts and actions, so that all may live in true peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray, dear friends, that God the Almighty Father may heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travelers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and rid the world of falsehood, hunger, and disease. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for an end to the war in Iraq, for the safe return of our servicemen and women, for the people of Iraq, and for the peace throughout the world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray as well for the health of Daphne Mills and Phil Vargas. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we also pray for young people everywhere and especially here at Holy Family Parish. We pray that they may know more deeply the love that they have from you, Father, and in the person of your only begotten Son. And we ask this through the love and the intercession of the Mother of God and of our Lord, as we pray together. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Please be seated as we prepare our altar.
We would like to
ask the ushers now to take up a collection. There is one collection taken up in churches around the world on Good Friday. It is for the shrines in the Holy Land where these sacred events took place. We thank you in advance for your generosity.
Our offertory song can be found in the Spirit and Song books at number 100, At the Name of Jesus.
Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess Him, King of glory now. Jesus is Lord, King of glory now.
At the name of Jesus.
At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess Him, King of glory now. Jesus is Lord, King of glory now. He emptied Himself as a slave yet free, came in human likeness for you and for me. In human likeness for you and for me. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall. King of glory.
Brothers, let us pray now with confidence to the Father in the words our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin and protect us from all anxiety as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now.
Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of all the world. How blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive thee, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you have restored us to life by the triumphant death and resurrection of your Christ. Continue this healing work within us. May we who participate in this mystery never cease to serve you. We ask all this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Two things before we close. First, I want to encourage everyone to come here tomorrow night at 8 p.m. to celebrate the great high feast of the year, the triumphant resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the inclusion in his body of so many who seek to become Catholic Christians. Join us for the great vigil tomorrow at 8 o'clock. I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank the so many who, through so much work, have made the presentation of the Passion this year and every year a possibility for our community. I'm always deeply moved by the way that the teens take to this story and tell it as well as I have ever heard it told. My friends, may the Lord be with you. Please bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Lord of love, send down your abundant blessing upon your people who have now devoutly recalled the death of your only begotten Son in the sure hope of the resurrection. Grant them pardon. Bring them comfort. May their faith grow stronger and their eternal salvation be assured. We ask all this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.